Does that encapsulate that, Graham?
Yeah.
What was the last thing that you said about that? Making it
authentic.
I like that word. It's awfully hard to know what authentic is in pieces that we never had recordings of from the masters themselves. I find it really interesting in the Casals book where he quotes Mozart. And, you know, Mozart is talking about the resonance of life in these music, and that the violins and octaves, for example, can't you feel the heartbeat from that? Can't you feel the tension, the inhalation and the exhalation from those octaves? And you go, wow, this person was really thinking about the meaning of the music, you know? Whereas others, we come along and theoretically analyze it, and we say, well, those are just octaves. Okay, but what does it mean, right? So what else is interpretation?
To bring to life what's not explicitly marked, to take what's not on the page and make something out of it.
Like that, bringing to life the implicit. Yeah, what's not marked. And again, Casals will say, you know, he would scream at orchestras, there are thousands of things in the score that are not marked, but we must do, right? Well, how do we come to know these thousands of things that are in the score that we are at liberty to do? And you use a one word, the opposite of which is explicit. So we have explicit musical markings. We have tempos, and we have things like rubato, but even rubato is somewhat implicit, isn't it? Because how much rubato? Unless there's a tempo marking at the end, we're not quite sure, you know, how much I should pull on that. So even with explicit markings, mezzo forte, well, in this piece, or that piece, or that setting, or this setting, a soloistic mezzo piano, an ensemble mezzo piano, a solo within an ensemble's mezzo piano. There's such a wide range, right? So even within the explicit markings, there are decisions that we have to make, right? So what else is interpretation? This is all good. What else is interpretation?
How about feelings, or the feel that someone is playing with the phrase or the structure of the music? I don't know, I would say.
Okay. And this is the hard one. How do I encapsulate that? Is there a statement I can make about feelings, putting feeling into music? Feelings into music. How do I do that? We all know what we mean by this, right? You know, I mean, a child knows what we mean by this. If I said to a kindergartner, so a five-year-old, if I said, sing me something sad, I bet you they would. If I said, sing me something happy, I bet you they could. If I said, sing me something playful, I bet you that they could improvise and make it up. The innocence of that age, it's raw, it's there, it can come out. It seems like the older we get, the harder it is for us sometimes. You know, you find your average teenager, your 18-year-old, and you say, please, play this with passion. And they start going, I don't know what that word means, you know. Is it something sexual? Is it something sensual? Is it something that I'm just excited about, you know? And your answer is, sure, it's all of those things. It can be any of those things, if you think that fits this moment. So how do we get to this moment? How do we make those decisions about what builds that and supports it? Well, go ahead.
I was going to say, sometimes what works with that, if it is that kind of age group that is a bit like, when it comes to emotion and feelings. You know, sometimes we can put a story with the music. It might not be a true story, it probably will be a true story, but something that you feel that will convey the emotion.
Sure. We do make up musical stories, musical movies. And sometimes we do that and it can seem a little trite. It can seem a little bit proscribed that, you know, maybe that doesn't really fit. How do we know It's much easier with modern composers, mm-hmm. right? Let's talk about Beethoven for a minute. What do you know about Beethoven and the Fifth Symphony? What do you remember from your history classes about Beethoven and the Fifth Symphony?
He was going deaf at that point.
Right, and so everybody's talking about the fact that all the angst that's in the Fifth Symphony is a result of his going deaf, losing that hearing, right? And we can even turn to some historical documents. We can look at the Heiligenstadt Testament, which is a letter to his sister that talks about all the things he was going through that got him to that point, right? But Beethoven never said. Beethoven never wrote the words, "I wrote this because I'm going deaf. I wrote this passage, this motive to express this." Today's composers do that very often. They do that, and we write for a purpose. The Minnesingers and the Meistersingers of the eras gone by, today, modern composers have taken a little bit of that. We write because of events in the world. David Gillingham's writing of Heroes Lost and Fallen, Vietnam War. His writing of, and I'm blanking on the title of it now, Be Thou My Vision, the Oklahoma City bombing. You know, so composers are writing about society. Well, isn't that what the Minnesingers and the Meistersingers were doing? Aren't they like the pop stars today? Or maybe the pop stars today have gone even on a different venture, and we're just borrowing from that tradition, you know, back then. So today's composers can prescribe things to their music, but we don't know that about Beethoven. We don't know that about Haydn. We make speculative guesses, and we study the history of it, right? Go ahead, Brian, if you'd like to stop that.